It's
this
awesome.
Weekend. So this next weekend is the Mexico Game and Squire.
Yeah, please come.
Also, you hopefully, some of you have received phone calls or you will be receiving phone calls to join the next round of Getting to Know You meals. If by any chance you were like, I meant to sign up for that, but totally forgot to email John, do me a favor, just come talk to me today, okay? We'll get you on the list. So, I am going to invite a number of people. It's going to be very crowded up here. So, will the following people please come up? Marty, Sharon Chamberlain, Beth Paycheck, Roxy Bradley, and Patty Jones. Come on in. Come on up. Something like that. And while they're coming up and getting their way up here, I'm going to announce, please notice in the fellowship hall there is a sock and mitten tree. We are collecting socks and mittens for the children of La Mesa Elementary School. So you can start bringing your socks and mittens. The other thing that is in the fellowship hall is on a Christmas Day luncheon. If you are interested in participating in that, either as a co-host or as just a participant bringing a side dish, there is a sign up in the fellowship hall, and you can talk to Ella Joan afterwards. She's one of our co-hosts. But we want to know if there's people who are interested this year. So, here we go. How about Marty first?
Well, I was waiting to
hear you.
I know I'm going to take a while. I told Chris if I take too long, she's to stand up and say time.
That's a question.
No. No matter, it's Chris that's going to have it. I wanted to talk to you all about the per capita. This is the time of year that you hear that we are collecting a per capita. And I have been fortunate enough to have been a party to each one of the levels of our church at some time. And I just felt like I'd like to share with you some of the things that justify why we give a per capita. It's not a tax on you like in the city. It's not a due bill that you're going to get. It's a tax so that our connectional church can function. You know what we do at La Mesa, the ones I see today. I don't need to go into La Mesa. You know that we're very busy. You know that we have seven committees of which we do different things. Environment, the food pantry, and social action are the things we're the most wound up in right now. Y'all know that. But I don't know how many of you know how connectional we are as a Presbyterian. The next level for us is the Presbytery. And this is made up of representatives from churches. And the determination, we have three here at La Mesa that are eligible to go. It's based on the number of ministers and lay people that attend. Our moderator this year will be John Sittler, who has been at Manal School for a long time. COM is the only commission where you have to have been installed to be on that committee. Other than that, it's made up of, the committees are made up of just everybody and anybody that wants to take the time to serve. The Presbytery works up workshops for the different things that go on in the church. And stewardship, work times when they'll do training for new officers. They do, it's not workshops, they do meeting times for ministers. They'll bring in people, and for a nominal fee, they can attend worship. Workshop. one point. Then there's the Synod. The Synod is our next conventional part of our component. And we're really lucky because we have the Synod exec who's a member of our church. That's Conrad. And under him is Sherry Yates, who is our associate stated clerk. And many of you know Sharon. Synod is our ecclesiastic appellate court. It's composed of four presbyteries, Santa Fe and Sierra Blanca here in New Mexico, De Cristo and Grand Canyon in Arizona. They meet twice a year, and they are a big aid to the presbyteries and then, of course, to the local churches. They furnish, they do lots of workshops. They did a large one on stewardship not too many years ago that was just marvelous as a help for those of us in the local church. They also have monies that different commissions can request and see if they qualify to get help with programs. They have a larger contact in the United States as to programs and people. They've run a series of what's called kaleidoscopes for ministers. And since it's for ministers, all I've heard is that it has been just really great. Then there's the General Assembly. That's our top dog. And it's made up of representatives from all the presbyteries. Are you going, Chris? It's not time. I'm almost there. Every presbytery, there's three people that go: a minister, a lay person, and a youth. And I was fortunate enough to attend that one year. The plenary is a session where all these people get together and they have workshops and they come back in the plenary and they vote on whether an amendment that has been set up from the different presbyteries will be passed or not passed. If it's passed there, it is sent down to the presbytery and we must vote on it at that level. Then we must send it back up to the General Assembly. And that makes differences in our book of worship, in our book of discipline, our book of government, that make up our book of order. This is the most inclusive group in our entire church, and it takes lots of money to fund all these different things. For me to attend General Assembly, it did not cost me a lot of money because that was picked up by General Assembly. They have to get the money from someplace. So every member of a presbytery of a local church is assessed $38 this year, and that is based on the total number of members we had last year, December 31st. And that money goes in some to the presbytery, some to the Synod, and some to General Assembly. And if you're able, think about when you hear that we need to pay our per capita. It is something you can't do, and if you can't do, just know that somebody else will cover part of it for you. It's not an option. The church has to pay that bill. So if you can help do, and if you can't, just know that you'll get it taken care of. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Patty Jones. Next Sunday, December 10th, will be our triannual blood drive at the Mesa Church. I have left a couple messages with a few of you, but if you can please sign up. I have seven people signed up right now.
and learn about Hefter International's mission to end hunger and poverty around the world while also caring for the earth. I'll be happy to show you how you can give a gift of hope and honor someone you love in your family at the same time. Thank you.
Another alternative gift is to purchase a card that explains how the food pantry works, and the cards are
$25.
The cards are $25, and when you purchase one of those to send to a friend or a relative, then the proceeds from the sale of those cards will help to enhance our food pantry budget, which you know is meeting an increasing need as the time has gone on. I'm seeing a lot more people come to our door, a lot of new people, a lot of people who haven't come and are coming back, and it is with grateful hearts that we are able to serve our neighbors, and I thank you very much.
Oh, almost done. So I'm here to talk about Arts Academy, one of our favorite missions of the church. This year we're doing something different. Some of us on the steering committee are actually making handmade ornaments that we'll have for sale next Sunday. We're kind of excited about trying this. They won't be expensive, but you know, it's a different way to thank somebody for something, or if you have kids, grandkids, some of them are pretty cool. So this Sunday and 2 weeks from today, Sharon will be set up with Heifer. A week from today, Roxy will be set up with gift cards for the food pantry. Arts Academy
you open and no one can close.
You set the prisoners free.
O radiant dawn, splendor of eternal light.
Sun of justice, come shine on those who live in darkness and in the shadow of death.
O ruler of all nations, you are the cornerstone uniting all humanity.
Come save us all.
O Emmanuel, our sovereign and lawgiver, desire of the nations,
and savior of all, come save us, O Christ. Come, let us worship God.
Hymn number 105.
Your mercy, forgive us. Grant us wisdom.
brings him good news. The wilderness will rejoice. The dry land will blossom.
The people of God will return with joy and singing. Amen.
Got it all choked up. It's so exciting. Here at Mesa, we pass the peace of Christ using American Sign Language because it puts into our hands the meaning of the words, the gesture, and the love. So we take the muck and mire and the peace of Christ, the nails and the hand, and we bring our hands together, be with you, and then you respond with and also with you. So the peace of Christ be with you,
and also with you.
Let us share the peace of Christ with one another. Oh.
Dear friends, the word Advent comes from the Latin word adventus, means coming. Advent in the 4th and 5th centuries was a time of preparation for the baptism of new Christians. Christians would spend 40 days in prayer and fasting to prepare for the celebration that accompanied the baptism of new believers. Today, we celebrate Advent over the 4 weeks leading up to Christmas each year. This year, we begin Advent on December 3rd and end this season in prayerful anticipation on the morning of December 24th. Advent season is an invitation to set your mind off the stresses of the year. We can take our focus off the crazy hustle that can be associated with the Christmas season that often threatens to produce more hassle than delight. Advent is a chance to focus our thoughts on the gift God has given us in His Son Jesus, who stepped down from heaven and took the form of a man so that we might believe.
The tradition of the first Sunday of Advent includes lighting the candle of hope. This candle of hope symbolizes promises delivered through the prophets from God, as well as the hope we have in Christ. God crafted a great rescue plan that is laid out in Scripture. This plan foretells years in advance the arrival of Christ. The stories of God's people also gives us a glimpse of the future and promises that God is creating a new heaven and a new earth among us today. Let us pray. God, let hope arise in our hearts. Lift our eyes up to see that you alone are where our hope comes from. Help us to shake off the anxiety, discouragements, and distractions that have filled our lives this year. May we pause to remember the gift and choice of hope in our lives. Give us the grace we need to wrap up this year joyfully. We invite your Spirit into this beautiful Advent season. Renew our sense of holy anticipation as we celebrate again the birth of the Christ child. More than anything, we ask that you are glorified in this season of holy expectation. Amen.
Thank you.
knowledgeable and to make your name known to your adversaries so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down. The mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. We meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and in our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our father, our mother, our source. We are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please rise in body or spirit for the receiving of the gospel according to Matthew. Mark. Hear now what the Spirit of God is saying to the church this day. But in those days, after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then God will send out the angels and gather the elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also when you see these things taking place, you know that God is near, at the very gates. Truly I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or that hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the child, the Son, but only the source of life. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a person going on a journey. When one leaves home and puts one's servants in charge, each with one's own work, and commands the doorkeeper to keep on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the owner of a house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn. Or else one may find you asleep when one comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
keep us awake. It is our tendency to slumber. It is our tendency to enter a ritual in which we forget all about you. It is our habit to blithely go on in life, now and then giving nod to you, saying an amen when something good comes our way, crying in fear when suddenly something is going awry, hoping that you will swoop in and save us in a Superman, Superwoman kind of style. And once that is done, we continue to totter on, moving on with a life filled with this and that, forgetting that you are above, below, and around us at all times, making us, creating us, and giving us opportunity to do it right, at least this one next time. So help us keep awake. When we start to drift off and sleep and forget about you, keep us awake. Break into our routine. Scramble up the puzzle pieces, and as the puzzle pieces come back down to earth, may the puzzle finally make sense. We pray these things in your holy name. And God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Well, that was a sermon unto itself. Amen. In the New York Times in the past few months, the reporter Holly Burns wrote an article titled, quote, "To Enjoy Life More, Embrace Anticipation." To enjoy life more, embrace anticipation. Holly begins with a story about Allie Pierce, who knows how to plan a vacation. Quote, "A few months out, she goes on a crazy kind of Google spree, constructing a spreadsheet of all the things she wants to do and see when she's on vacation. She scrutinizes the menus of restaurants she's planning to visit. She uses a picture of the destination as her phone's lock screen image and downloads a countdown app. What's so exciting, says Allie Pierce, what's so exciting about the trip is the anticipation before it even happens. Dr. Simon Rigo of Montefiore Medical Center adds, imagining a good thing ahead of us makes us feel better in the current moment. Let me say that again. Imagining a good thing ahead of us makes us feel better in the current moment. It can increase motivation, optimism, and patience, and decrease irritability. Anticipating a smattering of small, delightful experiences can be as enjoyable as looking forward to the one big event itself. Psychologist Kerry Weiland writes and continues, at the end of every day, do this. Suggestion for all of us, pastor included. Write down one thing or tell another person one thing that you're excited for tomorrow. One thing that you're excited for tomorrow. Maybe it's picking up a new book. Maybe it's getting a donut in the morning and bringing it to my staff. Or receiving a package that you're expecting, but you just can't wait till it gets there. Many of us, if not most, live and we hope fill our lives with joyful anticipation. Because it's not only fun, as the psychologists and socialists say, but it is the stuff of life. It is the stuff of life, and it is a good life at that. Anticipation of something rewarding is something we all know well with our entire being, our mind, our spirit. There is one scene in The Music Man that I always look forward to with great anticipation. It is when the young Ron Howard struts up to the street and breaks out from the crowd and sings in The Music Man, "Oh, the Wells Fargo wagon is coming now. I don't know how I could wait to see. It could be something for someone who is no relation, but it could be something special just for me. You remember that? I told the class, go deeper, when we were going over hymns, two songs today in the sermon.
That show was playing at the Rhodey Theater.
I just love it when he breaks out and sings with that lisp and all. And his mother, of course, comes and comforts him. We know how we feel when we look forward to seeing someone get home and to tell them all the news of the day that happened when we were children. We know what it's like to get that phone call from someone we weren't expecting, a text, a visit from someone special, and all the butterflies within us that flutter in our stomachs. They're here. Do you remember looking out the window when you're waiting for someone to come? Are they here yet? That's the feeling of anticipation, where we all feel that high expectation. For example, we wait for the money to finally come from the sale of the house. Woo! Or we receive word that the new car we wanted has arrived at the dealership. We're as equally excited to know that it's there as getting it. We get excited for birthdays, ours or others alike, as well as anniversaries. Many of us feel that high feeling of waiting to see and hear if the school we wanted to get into for college or university sends us a thick packet with an acceptance letter, with a scholarship attached to it. We waited with hopes to receive the grade for the past semester, and we are so excited when we see the A, but we thought we were getting a D. We waited to hear the good news of seeing that infant we've been waiting for all these years. We waited to hear about the good news of a medical diagnosis or a job we really wanted, all good news. We looked forward with hope when we were proposing to someone, will you marry me? And they say yes. And even this, heck, anyone who has ever taken a child or been the adult who had to get a flu shot or a shot at all, we look forward to the ice cream or the lollipop in that moment. I still ask them for a lollipop. So far, CBS is not granted. Granted, anxiety and anticipation can coexist, live together. They are, after all, sibling emotions. Think about it. That first time you bought a house or you rented your first apartment, you felt both that jumble of, I can't wait to do this, and oh my God, what have I just done? When we sent off that child, now a young adult, and the nest is empty, we're excited about what they're going to do in their lives, and yet we're scared about, oh my God, what are they going to do? Will they get home all right? As they go into adulthood, we have both of those feelings. Anxiety and anticipation, even when we are facing something that we may dread, one thing that all psychologists and sociologists say as a tactic to repurpose our personal lives, look forward to it without dreading. Take, for example, a long car trip. We go, oh my God, do I have to do this again? Frame it instead as an adventure with little stories in between. Exciting times meeting people that you would never have met at that McDonald's, at that Starbucks, at Bucky's. And if we frame life as an adventure, anticipating new and wonderful and silly and sometimes weird things, we would get excited about life in ways that we never thought were possible. Second song, Carly Simon gets it right. Anticipation. Anticipate, you know the song. We can never know about the days to come, she sings, but we think about them anyway. And I wonder if I'm really with you now or just chasing after some finer day. Anticipation. Sing along. Anticipation is making me late. It's keeping me waiting. Of remapping, of reimagining what could cause high anxiety and dread within us anticipation of something positive and audacious wandering into our life, wonderful at the core of the message. That is at the heart what's going on with the words, the psalm of the prophet Isaiah, and with Jesus in Matthew's gospel this first Sunday of Advent, which is all about hope, as Cheryl and Susan shared with us. It is, as you will see from the title of the sermon, it is a message of holy anticipation. In Isaiah, one can see and feel the spirit of anticipating the presence of the holy to save them, again, demoralized people of Israel from themselves and their actions in this passage. From the reading of the book, the prophet Isaiah. Historical context, if you will. After a decree by King Cyrus the Persian around 538 years before Christ, ending yet one more exile of the Jewish people one more time in their favorite vacation location, Babylon, a number of those exiled now returned to Judah, returned to Jerusalem, Holy Temple, all burnt asunder, in particular to rebuild now the crumpled kingdom. When confronted with the difficulties of the return, there is a sense of hope coupled with doubt, lament, anxiety, anticipation. The people expect that a Thor-like God would burst onto the scene to save them once again from the future of their own making. They are stuck again in the muck, mud, and mire of their own making. Out of the state of woe, expecting the warrior God, Thor-like, to show up, the prophet speaks a word of audacious hope and provides them with an image of God that shifts everything that they knew. When all hope seemed lost, the chasm between God and God's people was growing wider and drifting apart even wider. When they thought they had lost and had really kind of bent the covenant to the extreme, the prophet makes this unexpected observation. Yet you, O God, you are our source of life. We are clay, and you, God, are potter. We are the work of your hands. Don't be exceedingly angry, O God, and do not remember our iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. From the image of God as a saving divine warrior, Thor-like without the hammer, bursting out of heaven, comes this passage in which Isaiah brings a poem, this poem, to a very different place than where the people, Isaiah included, expected to go. Warrior God is now God the artisan. Warrior God is a potter, working, molding, fashioning, still fashioning to this day. It's important to remember when hearing this story, the kiln door has not been opened yet. There's not been a fire yet. Right? The glaze is still wet. Even today. God is still fashioning a people today. The clay, us, we are still wet. We are still moldable. We are still able to be shaped. We are still being crafted and created by God for God's own purposes. The creative, constructive, artistic God is still underway, having a wonderful time at doing it. There is still hope, both for our forebears, for us, and our kith and kin in the future. Holy anticipation is now, that we know that the holy is still pottering away, and the future brims with holy hopes. This theme of holy anticipation continues with Mark's Jesus. There is a high sense of anticipation with the last story in this passage in which a person is going on a journey, leaving home, in charge of the help, God help him, each with work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the owner of the home, God, will come, in the evening or at midnight or at cockcrow or at dawn, or else the owner, God, may find you asleep when the owner comes suddenly. What else can I say but this? Keep going. Verses 34 through 37. To keep a vigil like this is to live in a state of holy anticipation, a spiritual practice of always paying attention. In her book, An Altar in the World, Episcopal writer Barbara Brown Taylor calls us to keep awake, to pay attention to the world around us and all that is sacred, all that is holy, all that is beautiful therein. Quote, regarded properly, she writes, anything can become a sacrament, by which I mean an outward and visible sign of an inward and spiritual presence. It is as simple as looking twice at people and things you might just easily ignore. It is one way into a different way of life, a life full of treasure for those who are willing to pay attention to exactly where they are, who they are, and whose they are. You see, Jesus is urging us to pay attention, to live in a kind of holy anticipation for the full and final inbreaking of God's realm of love when it breaks through. When we do this, when we commit ourselves to the spiritual practice of paying attention or living in holy anticipation, we find that we catch glimpses of the reign or realm of God's love each and every day. For example, when Cheryl and Susan lit the flame, we see it in the dancing of a candle flame. God breaking through, lit for Advent. We see it in the deep questions that come when we are unable to sleep at night. We write it down and then we go, oh, in the morning. We see it in the wonder of stars that rise at night after the storm passes by. It is embodied by the one who dozes in a hospital recliner by a loved one. It is in the twitching of a cat's or a dog's ear or in the purr of it is in the voice of one crying out for justice and peace in war-torn parts of the world, and the voice is heard. It is in the moment in which equality and compromise breaks through our deep divisions in this country. It is in the whisper, thank you, for someone who just received food for the day, clothes for the day, shelter for the night. God's presence all the holy gift of work, holy anticipation abounds. Every day, Jesus again whispers to us and in our ears, keep awake. Keep awake. Keep awake, I am here. For God's realm has been breaking into our mundane world throughout the centuries. God's realm is still breaking into our world today and will continue inviting us to live in holy anticipation. Do you see it? Can you hear it? Are you aware of it? It's coming right through the door. There! There! Because of it, we have already been paying attention. We are awakened to and live a vigil for the world around us, living on the edge of holy anticipation. Oh, the Wells Fargo wagon, nothing. Oh, God. Yeah. So an invitation from pastor to congregation and back to pastor. Let us live in the holy anticipation of God's breaking in and what is coming and what is. After all, we get more happiness, as we were told by the psychologists and sociologists, from anticipating spiritual moments than attaining mere material possessions. This includes moments of the inbreaking of God's presence in our lives today and all the days of our lives. For the whole story of Advent is the story of how God cannot be kept out. Think of that again. The whole story of Advent is by how God cannot be kept out of this world, kept out of our lives, keeps breaking in, for the extraordinary potter continues to create and breathe into the mud and mire of our own existence and fashions and molds and sculpts and reshapes our lives come what may. As the prophet Isaiah observed, for God cannot help God's self from continuing to enter into the life of creation and join us in being proactive in practicing justice, proactive in entering a bond with others in the acts of loving kindness, proactive as we roll along and walk humbly with the Holy One, in Christ Child reminds us this truth. God is with us. Let me say that again. God is with us. For us. By our side. That's why we live in a state of holy anticipation, because we've experienced this before time and time and time again in this season, because God continually shows up in our collective lives, not with a parade, but with a whimper of a baby. Of a baby. Of an infant. Not among the powerful and the greedy, but among the marginalized others. Not with the demanding, loud, authoritarian voice of tyrants, but with a humble, squalling, quiet, sleeping, mumbling, baby, born in a rough manger, in Bethlehem, outside of Jerusalem, the capital, the one who is the hope, the only hope, the one hope of a broken world, still breaking through our cluttered, distracted, short attention span lives. So let us live in the continual, constant state of holy anticipation, because you know when it happens, table, you will see the offering plate. This is our time to go ahead and give. support the ongoing work, the presence of the body of Christ here, not only in the International District, but in the city of Albuquerque. So please come forward or use the QR code that is found in the pew before you, and please consider in what ways you may support the ongoing work of Christly love in this world.
Thank you.
might reflect the earth-shaking importance of Christ's coming.
Help us to give ourselves generously, for we do not know the time, the day, or hour. We praise these things in your beloved name. Amen.
Please be seated. Before we begin in celebrating this meal, just a few caveats for you to be aware of. We are singing the Holy, 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 as well as the Christ has died, Christ has risen, and Amen, with the tune that our own David Poole wrote that is in the Glory to God hymnal. We have sung it for the last few weeks, but again, I want to give God thanks for David Poole, who gave us a jazzy kind of black and African-American spiritual song tune to sing it to. So thank you very much for your gift of music and that we are able to share that here in this congregation. We went through and talked about hymns in the last hour going deeper. When we get to the Hosanna, Hosanna part, just understand this. I will have just gone through all the story about God and God's people in Hebrew scripture. When we sing that holy, 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 and we sing Hosanna, 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 it is the people of God saying, God, save us. We are actually bringing the words from Palm Sunday into our modern day context. And we are now saying, God, save us, as the people did when Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem. Then I will go through the story of Jesus, in which we will say, Christ has died, Christ has risen. And we are saying what happened in Golgotha. Then it ends with this. I will call upon the Holy Spirit to be present here today in the now. Holy anticipation. And we will sing amen, so be it, at the very end of that. For each and every time that it's your turn to sing, I'll go ahead and give you the right hand and say, now. When we come to sharing the meal, in this bread is gluten-free bread. Feel free if you need and must. This is for those who have a reaction to wheat. So that is there. For others, we are going to invite you to go ahead and take the bread, dip it in the cup. This is a practice known as intinction. We dip it in, and then the person giving you the bread will say something like, this is the body of Christ broken for you. The person with the cup or with the tray will simply say words like this. This is the cup of love, and this is the cup of salvation, this is the blood of Christ, whatever the person wishes. And your response at that time can be, Alleluia, Amen, or if you're a good old Episcopalian or Catholic, go ahead and feel free to cross yourselves at that time, or if you're Greek Orthodox, it's the other way around. Ready? So let us enter into this time, this wonderful period in which we celebrate this gift of bread and cup. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Friends, I have a story to tell you. It is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise, O Lord our God, creator and ruler of the universe. The story of old is you formed us in your image. As we remember today the words of the prophet Isaiah, and you set us in this world to love and serve you. When we were captives in slavery, especially our kith and kin, you delivered us to freedom. You made covenant to be our one sovereign God. When we were stubborn and stiff-necked, you still spoke to us through prophets like Isaiah. And we looked forward and we looked forward for that day when justice shall triumph and peace shall reign over all the earth. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with the celestial choirs and with all the faithful of every time and place who forever sing to the glory of your name.
Oh.
You sent Christ into the world to bring freedom to the captives of sin, to establish justice for those who are oppressed. Christ came among us to be one of us, taking the lot of the poor, sharing human suffering, dying an unjust death at the hands of the state. We rejoice that in his dying and rising again, you set before us the sure promise of new life, the certain hope of a heavenly home where we will sit at table with Christ our host. Remembering your gracious acts in Jesus Christ, we take from your creation this bread, this cup, and we joyfully celebrate Christ dying and rising as we, the people of God today, await the day of Christ's coming in the form of a Christ child in the spirit of Advent. With thanksgiving, we offer our very selves to you to be a living, a holy sacrifice dedicated to your service. Give you thanks, O Christ, that on the night of your arrest, we remember that Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sin. Every time you drink of it, do this in remembrance of me." So every time we eat this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim with our lives the saving love of Jesus Christ until he comes again in glory. And the people of God said, Amen. We will come up single file. I'm going to ask the elders, those who are helping today, to come forward. friends, Jesus is the bread of life. We drink from the cup of salvation. Feel free to come down the center aisle.
For our communion hymn today, we're going to use this smaller book.
lives in body or spirit. Continues anon as our worship comes to an end. See you on the trail.